All right, good afternoon, everybody. I'm Chris Manning, and I lead our flow cytometry group at Cell Signaling Technology. And as Matt was just discussing, you know, there are many different ways to approach analyzing your samples. And what I'm going to be focusing on here is taking it from the step where you might have a specific target or targets in mind that you want to look at, and we want to look at phosphorylation of these proteins, specifically by flow cytometry. And most of my talk is going to be covering the approaches that you can take in terms of protocols to help combine the signaling that you might be trying to read out along with phenotyping of your samples by flow. And I'm basing this talk on feedback that we get discussing our products with customers, both here at conferences like this with all of you, but also through the technical support that we receive, the questions that we receive from people who are performing these assays and reach out to us for advice. So I've distilled the common questions that we receive into several different topics here that I'm going to cover throughout the course of this talk. So first of all, to step back and ask the question, why would you want to perform phospho-flow? Why would you want to be analyzing phosphorylated proteins by flow cytometry? As you may know, there are roughly 370 CD markers that you can use for phenotyping, and about 1,400 extracellular proteins that you could read out on live cells. And this is where most flow cytometry is being run, on live cells targeting extracellular proteins. But if you start looking inside the cell, you get a much broader range of information that you could potentially acquire and start looking at not just what is this cell, but what is this cell doing and how is that happening. Much of this analysis is being done by Western blot, as you know. And actually, can I get a show of hands? How many people here are currently analyzing signaling or have analyzed signaling by Western blot? Great. Okay, it's about half the room. It's helpful for me to know who I'm speaking to here and who's got this background. So, as you know, this is a common approach. It's a great way to read out phosphorylation, but there are several advantages and disadvantages to Western. Advantages being that you can actually visualize the size of visualize the molecular weight of your target. So you can see that, yes, this antibody is detecting what I think it's detecting. You're also able to then, say, ignore nonspecific bands. If you have an antibody that's giving you some cross-reactivity potentially, you could choose to ignore it if you want to. Your viewers may not be pleased, but you have that option, right? And the last thing is that when you're running Western, you've denatured all of the proteins there, so you've standardized your assay by linearizing these proteins. It makes it easier for the antibodies to bind. It's much more standard landscape for the antibody to perform in. But there are some disadvantages, too. The largest one is the first here, that you can't analyze subpopulations, and clearly this is something that you can do by flow. It's more difficult to multiplex, especially if you have proteins that are similar in molecular weight, and slower and less quantitative than what you'd be able to accomplish using flow cytometry. But clearly, again, most people running live cell flow are going to run into the significant issue here where antibodies cannot get across the plasma membrane and are not going to be able to bind to these intracellular targets, which is where almost all that phosphorylation is occurring. So this leads to the first question that we receive, and that is, what protocol should I use to do phospho-flow? Phospho-flow, intracellular flow, there's a lot of names for it. We're just talking about labeling proteins on the inside of the cell with an antibody. And there are a lot of misconceptions about this. And one of them is that there's some magic protocol out there that is going to work or that you need to use. And on one hand, that would be nice because then you could use it consistently across the board. But in reality, it's not so easy. That can be a pro for you, though, too, because you're not locked into one thing that may not be compatible with other antibodies you might want to use. So in reality, you can use a variety of different fix and perm conditions to detect phosphorylated proteins by flow cytometry. And generally, we want to start with a recommended protocol, something that a manufacturer might be providing as a recommendation. But I wanted to give you just an overview of the workflow in general. You're going to start with fixing your cells. This can be done with an aldehyde fixative, a cross-linking fixative like formaldehyde. It can be done with methanol. But you want to fix them first because you're going to need to permeabilize the cells. And if you permeabilize them first, you're going to make them unhappy if you haven't already locked those proteins down. incubate your antibodies toward those intracellular targets, and then you're going to acquire them. But what you need to consider is that if you are varying your protocol from either what was recommended by us as a manufacturer or what other people have done in your lab, you know that you're going to impact the binding of that antibody based on any one of these conditions. And some antibodies are more flexible than others, and I'll show the data regarding that in a few slides. So one of the things we want to touch on is permeabilization, because this is a question that we receive frequently. And what should I use to permeabilize my cells? So there's different ways to permeabilize, and I'm highlighting three of the common ones here. One is a selective detergent, like saponin. This is a protein that, this is a substance that interacts with proteins, the cholesterol on the plasma membrane of the cell surface. So you're specifically opening pores in the plasma membrane. It's going to allow the antibody to get in, but it's not going to really enable access to nuclear proteins. You can have non-selective detergents like Triton, which are going to permeabilize more broadly, enable more access to organelles within the cell. And then a solvent like methanol is going to essentially bust the doors down. That's going to provide the most access to those organelles within the cell, but it's also most disruptive to the landscape that antibody is now seeing, essentially, when it's inside the cell. You can cause proteins to be reshaped, essentially, because you're exposing hydrophobic regions and refolding those proteins. Some antibodies care about this, if you will. Some don't. As I mentioned, some can be very, very permissive. They'll be flexible across different protocols. So this is an example of our phosphorylated our antibody targeting phosphorylated S6. And I'm showing cells here that were treated with or without a PI3K inhibitor, LY294002. And you can see that across these different permeabilization conditions, whether we're permeating with methanol or with Triton or saponin, the antibody is giving about the same signal and about the same shift between these conditions. If you can contrast that with our phospho-stat 1 antibody here with Jerkis treated with or without IFN alpha. And you can see that this antibody prefers methanol permeabilization. You get the broadest difference between our peaks here, the most signal in those treated cells. When you permeabilize with Triton, or especially saponin, which, as I mentioned, doesn't give access to nuclear proteins, you lose that ability to differentiate your positive signal in your treated cells. So to summarize that, just know that you want to make sure you're starting with a protocol from a reliable source. So again, we provide a protocol that we have used internally that we know works with the data that we're presenting on our website, so you can always use that as a starting point. We understand that you might need to use a different protocol if you're trying to multiplex, trying to build a panel with other antibodies that might need another protocol. So I'm trying to make the point here that antibodies can be flexible. You don't have to be locked in, but it's a great idea to start with a known protocol. If it's something that's been established in your lab and has been validated, then if you're varying from your protocol conditions, at least do the work to make sure that antibody is still specific in these other conditions. And I want to show that this isn't true just for phosphorylation. This is true for other post-translational modifications as well. What I'm showing here, the flow cytometry data are all generated with formaldehyde fixation followed by methanol permeabilization. The immunofluorescence images were all used, were all generated with formaldehyde fixation followed by Triton permeabilization. So we've got a solvent and a detergent here. Same antibody acquired in two different assays. And you can see that not just phosphorylation, but also protein cleavage or methylation or acetylation are also, they also fall into this sort of flexibility where you don't need to be using one specific set of conditions in order to acquire this. So I'm bringing this up because there's a perception that, say, methanol is required to do phospho-flow, and it's just not the case. You have some flexibility there. It's going to be antibody dependent. It's going to be target dependent. I'd love to be able to say, here's the one golden answer that you can use every time. It's just not the case. So we, as I said, provide a protocol for any antibody that we recommend for flow, but we're also wanting to let you know you've got options there if you're trying to build a panel. So if things are so optional and you've got all these flexibilities, why isn't it working then? You know, that's the other question we have. You know, hey, I've got this antibody that works great by Western. I'm running it by flow, and I and it's not working. Why is this? So I wanted to do a brief overview of what we see as common problems. And one thing you need to consider is that antibody performance is going to be dependent upon what epitope it's binding to, what the landscape is, what, you know, what does that look like based on what protocol you're using, and then also how likely is it for that antibody itself to cross-react with other proteins. So to give you some examples here of what I'm talking about, so why does the epitope matter? As you can imagine, with two different protocols, depending on where an epitope is, for example, the red epitope here I'm showing with this red triangle, that might be accessible. You could bind that in either protocol if you had an antibody, but if this, in this case here, we've got an antibody binding this green epitope on the same protein, which in one protocol is visible, and another one it's not. It could also be due to where that epitope is located relative to the membrane. If you've got an extracellular epitope versus an intracellular epitope, for example, that might determine whether or not this antibody is able to bind. Okay, then you've got the landscape. You know, what is this antibody exposed to based on your protocol? And you might have conditions in one protocol where a potential cross-reactive epitope is masked. It may not be exposed. Another protocol might actually now make that available for the antibody to cross-react to. And then the third situation, same exact scenario, but now it's just that one antibody might be more likely to cross-react with that second epitope than the other. Point being, there are many variables to consider. This can be either the antibody's fault, it could be the protein's fault, or it could be the fault of everything else in the cell. So it's, again, bearing in mind when you change conditions in your protocol, you might be causing that antibody to cross-react. And this is where it's difficult by flow, because all you get is raw fluorescence. You may not know that some of that fluorescence is coming from non-specific binding, whereas again, by Western, you might be able to see other bands that are showing up when you've changed your protocol. You might be able to understand that something has changed. So this is why it's very important, if you change your protocol, to do what you can to revalidate that antibody in this new protocol. Another reason that it might not work is timing. You know, phosphorylation, this is a transient event, and sometimes people are trying to look at, say, T-cell signaling in response to T-cell activation, but they might be doing a 3 or 7 day stimulation of these T-cells and then expecting to see things like SLIP76 phosphorylation days after the cell is actually, the cell response was initiated. And so what I'm showing here are phospho-SLIP76 and also phospho-S6. At different time points after CD3, CD28 stimulation of PBMCs, and you can see that they both come on within 10 minutes, but you start seeing a decrease in signal just by 6 hours of time. And so, you know, when you're talking a day later, there's nothing left at that point. So it's critical to understand the biology of your system. If you don't know what that biology is, if you're looking at something that hasn't been well studied, then you've got to do that work to characterize that time point, because you're not going to know by flow whether, if you're not seeing signaling, is it that the antibody's not working? Is it that the protein has already been phosphorylated and dephosphorylated before you've gone to acquire your signal? And then the most tricky part, the most tricky question that we receive is how do I get my phenotypic CD marker analysis to work in combination with intracellular readouts? And I really wish that there was one golden answer to this, because this is the tricky part, and we know this is a headache for everyone in the industry trying to combine these two. So I wanted to at least provide some insights into different approaches that you can take. And one of them is just the order of operations that you do the experiment with. So the ideal situation is what I'm showing here, where you could fix your cells, permeabilize them, and then add your cocktail of antibodies, your extracellular phenotypic antibodies, your intracellular signaling antibodies all at once. So you have one incubation step, one wash step, and you're done. As you know, that doesn't always work. Some of the CD markers, they've been raised against live cells. They work on native protein, but once you cross-link those proteins with formaldehyde, you might be essentially stapling these things down to the cell surface, and that antibody can no longer bind where it wants to bind. So an alternative approach is to label those cells first, then fix them with formaldehyde. That's going to cross-link the antibodies to the proteins they're binding to. You can permeabilize then. You're not going to lose antibodies throughout this process, and then come in with your signaling readouts. This will work very well for your phenotypic readouts, but it can be challenging if you're trying to combine this with, say, a short time point activation of your cells. And when do you want to add your phenotypic antibodies prior to stimulating your cells without necessarily causing signaling as a result of adding those antibodies themselves? So another possibility is to treat your cells, fix them, stain your surface markers, and then permeabilize. We don't find that this is very often helpful. Oftentimes, the antibodies are sensitive to fixation itself, and so the permeabilization agent isn't really what is causing the problem. But this is also a potential solution if you can't quite get something to work with a different permeabilization agents that you've got, but if it's not fixation sensitive. So to show some examples of phenotypic markers that are sensitive to the different fixation reagent, different fixation conditions, here what I'm showing is the first workflow I discussed where we fix the cells, permeabilize them, and then come in with those CD markers. You can see that here I've got CD3 and CD4, two different clones, and different fixed perm conditions that I'm showing top to bottom. And you can see that these work well in any of these conditions. So these would be great. You could add them after you've fixed perm. You could combine them with your signaling readouts without a problem. But looking at CD11C and CD14, you can see here that while CD14 does maintain some separation throughout the conditions, CD11C doesn't start out with much separation to begin with, and you really lose it with the different fixed perm conditions. And so we've done some work with the CD markers that we offer and are building tables that we're going to put up on our website shortly to be able to help you understand which antibodies you can use in the fixed perm conditions as part of a protocol versus other ones that we know are problematic. So here are human reactive CD markers where you can see column on the left is if you add them live, how well do they work? And then going across, formaldehyde fix the cells and then either not permeabilize them just to look at, okay, are they sensitive to formaldehyde fixation or then these different permeabilizations as I've shown. And with also the FOX-P3 kit, which is a lower formaldehyde fixation concentration. And then we also have the mouse reactive CD markers here that I'm showing. And you can see that you've got several that do work well and aren't sensitive to fixation. You could combine those with your intracellular readouts without a problem, and others that do become problematic once you've fixed the cells. My last point that I would make is if you do add your CD markers ahead of time, just be aware that different fluorophores can be sensitive to solvents. So as you may know, methanol is going to denature protein fluorophores like PE, APC, and cause a lack of signal. So here's an example of CD3 with FITC or CD3 with PE. These were added to the cells first. The cells were then fixed, and we were permeabilizing with methanol. And you can see that, let's see if I can get this here to work. Well, on the right-hand side, that third plot down, you can see that you entirely lose signal with the PE fluorophore after you've exposed it to methanol. So be aware that you've got to take that into consideration as well. If you're going to add antibodies first and then permeabilize with the solvent, you don't want to disrupt your fluorescence. So several tips, several comments on how you can get this to work. But the biggest one I'd like you to take away is that, again, I'm presenting this based on feedback I hear from all of you. Please feel free to give us more feedback. You can contact us, my team, through our technical support page on our website. Those requests come directly to us. So if you're trying to get an assay up and running and wanting some help in terms of what we might know about protocol flexibility or what we might know about other CD markers if we've tried them in combination with our antibodies, feel free to reach out to us for advice, and we'd be happy to help save you some time in terms of trying to get that assay up and running. We also have a booth here, so feel free to swing by and ask us directly too. With that, I'd like to thank you, and Matt and I will be happy to take any questions from you.